Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. After nearly 7 years as ASU's athletic director, Lisa Love is out of a job. An ASU news release says Love is leaving the university to pursue other opportunities. But sources told the Arizona Republic she met with ASU President Michael Crow on Tuesday and was fired sometime during or after that meeting. Today, ASU named Steve Patterson as Love's replacement, pending approval by the Board of Regents. Patterson was hired in July as the chief operating officer for Sun Devil Athletics. Today, the state Senate voted down a controversial contraception bill. The bill would have allowed employers and insurance companies to refuse to cover contraception for religious reasons. The legislation may not be dead. Supporters are planning to bring it back before the end of the session. Well, the time will come when many of us can afford to purchase and possess our own genetic codes. But what will we do with that information? The moral and ethical questions related to knowing the secrets contained in our own DNA are explored in Cracking Your Genetic Code, an episode of NOVA that airs tonight right here on 8HD. Here's a brief clip from the program.
Information is always hard to handle.
One example is a piece of genetic information so potentially disturbing that even a founder of modern gene science refused to take a chance on running into it.
James Watson, the man who co-discovered the double helix of DNA, one of the very first people in the world to have his genome completely sequenced, he said to the scientists who were doing the sequencing, "There's one gene I don't wish to know anything about."
Known as APOE4 on chromosome 19, it has been associated with late-onset Alzheimer's, the leading cause of dementia in the elderly. The variant increases one's risk 3 to 10-fold.
But what does that mean? What does it mean to say you have a 10-fold increased risk over someone who doesn't have it? Can you then convert that into an absolute lifetime risk type of number to say, here's your percent chance of getting the disease? No, because you need to know what other genes work with APOE. You need to understand how lifestyle is working together with APOE.
In fact, many people with APOE4 never get Alzheimer's, while others with the disease don't have the variant.
I think the real key here is to disabuse people of the misunderstanding that genetics is wholly deterministic. In a few rare instances, there is a tight linkage between a particular mutation and a disease. But the vast majority of genetic information is largely probabilistic.
And joining me now to talk about the complex moral and ethical questions raised by this issue is Stephanie Buchholtz, Director of the Office of Research Compliance and Quality Management for TGen, Gary Marchant, a geneticist, law professor, and faculty director of the Center for Law, Science, and Innovation at ASU's Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law, and George Poste, chief scientist for ASU's Complex Adaptive Systems Initiative and a professor of health innovation. Good to have you all here. Thanks for joining us. Let's get the basics here. We'll start. What is a genome sequence?
So a genome sequence is, as people, we're made up of DNA, which is the building blocks are amino acids, and then the amino acids make your DNA, and they make nucleotides. And basically, it's like reading a sentence. So you have four nucleotides, A, T, G, and C, and we read those like a sentence, which make a book, which tell us what we're going to look like. And the genome, the human genome, is the genetic makeup of a human being. But there's a mouse genome and a strawberry genome, anything that's living.
And, okay, so with that book and those sentences, what can this tell us about our health?
Little bits at a time. So we're at a very early stage of this technology. There are some tests that are very important for your health, say a BRCA gene for breast cancer that some women have. Others are more probabilistic, like the Alzheimer's gene test that we just talked about, that it's not deterministic at all, it just increases your probability. And then the issue is, do you want to know that, and how can you use it if you do get it?
Talk more about that issue of, should we know this? Should we?
Yes, in part, but also I think the question has to be asked in advance of that is, what are the standards we're going to apply just to the analysis of your sequence? There's a lot of work which is done whereby DNA is analyzed on different machines, you get entirely different results. And the FDA is having a long, hard look at this, because if genetic sequencing is going to be used for healthcare decisions, then quite rightly people should expect the most stringent analytical standards to be used.
I should ask, how would we find out about our genetic code? Simple blood test, something along those lines?
It varies. It can be taken from body fluids like blood, urine, saliva, skin scrapings. In the case of cancer patients, usually it's a piece of tissue biopsy of the cancer, so it's very variable.
I asked how much we should know about our own genetic code. How much should, how much will others know about our genetic code?
Well, right now it's a matter of individual choice how much you want to know. Different people have different views on this. So I've been genetically tested for a whole bunch of different ones from one of these companies. I want to know. I know people who don't want to know. So it's a matter of individual choice in terms of your own knowledge. In terms of what other people want to know, that's where it gets more scary. We do have some protection now. We have a statute that protects employers and health insurers from getting that information. But there's nothing to stop anybody else from taking my cup tonight and bringing this to a lab and getting it tested and testing my DNA right there and finding out what they want to about me.
And that's scary stuff.
Maybe. For me, no one's going to do it. But if you're a politician or a media celebrity or an athlete, maybe it is.
And I think we also need to define what we mean by a genetic test. There's a big difference between predisposition testing, namely what lurks in my genetic code that might bite me in later life, versus if I've got a disease today, the analysis, I want the best possible analysis as to how my genes affect how my disease is going to progress. And if you take something like cancer, very important to profile genes in that cancer to select the best drug.
So can you, I mean, when all of this becomes de rigueur, can you keep this information secret? Is it possible?
At this point in time, yes. I mean, there's a big controversy. A lot of people say privacy is going away, but confidentiality is still in place. So at TGen, we do hold genome sequencing, mainly on cancer patients, but a variety of our studies do it. And we are able to code the information such that TGen does not necessarily know who the people are in our studies. And the hospitals do, but we may not. So we're kind of anonymizing the data in a way where the data exists, but it exists with the code. It doesn't exist with Gary's name on it. But that's different with medical testing, because medical testing, you are the patient, and it does have a code on it.
Well, one of the issues that raises, though, is when they do find something that could be used to help someone's health, and they might be in a lot of trouble without finding it, do they have any duty to report that? And there was just a report this last week of a bunch of experts who said, in fact, they do, that even though maybe legally they might not have the authority to do that right now, that they might have an ethical duty to go back to that patient, even though they don't know the person's name.
Yeah, so a good example is, so we do targeted testing at TGen for cancer, so we'll get a tumor biopsy and look at specific genes that we could target for a drug. However, maybe we find something completely different because we have the genes for the entire human genome, and maybe we find something for the APOE4 gene. Do we have a duty to disclose that information?
It's called the incidental loan.
Yeah, well, incidental findings.
Right. Do you have a duty?
So currently, no. According to the courts, we do not, because researchers are not doctors. It is not in our obligation. However, what we usually do is we would convene a committee made up of physicians and ethicists and some other people and actually discuss, is this information something that we feel we need to give back to the patients?
And that would bring up liability concerns as well for doctors, would it not? I mean, a doctor could know something or not know something, and if something develops later in life with the patient, all of a sudden here comes litigation.
Absolutely, but it also extends beyond the patient, because assuming that your paternity and maternity is as you believe it is, then the genes that you possess also may exist not only in your parents, but also your children.
So there are a few cases where the doctor has been sued for not disclosing it, not the matter of disclosing it to the patient, but not going beyond the patient, disclosing it to patient's family members, because the patient doesn't want them to know. Does a doctor have an independent duty to go around their own patient and talk to their relatives? And the courts are split on that, but there are some cases saying the doctor does have that duty.
Interesting. Now, personal ethics involved here as well. Mm-hmm. The concept of telling your mate. You may know that you are susceptible to something that could be passed along to future generations, your children. I mean, what do you do then? Do you tell the mate this? Do you tell your boss that, in about 10 years, there's a 3 in 10 chance that I could get X, Y, and Z? Where does it all end?
up to the person currently. I mean, that person has a right whether or not they want to disclose the information. A big question right now is also, do they have a right to get that information? A lot of people are arguing with the direct-to-consumer companies that Gary used to actually sequence his own DNA. A lot of people say, no, we shouldn't be doing direct-to-consumer. You need to go through a physician to get this information.
But even if you go through a physician, it comes back to this issue of standards. Mm-hmm. That I could have my genome sequenced and the whole series of putative risks exist, but there, as was pointed out in the Nova show, most of this is probabilistic. Each of us in this room might have, quote, a susceptibility gene. Some of us would go down with it, others wouldn't, because we've got other genes that modulate the effect of that gene.
Back to the personal ethics aspect of this. So if you find out that you have X, Y, and Z, right, do you have a responsibility to tell your family members, you know, right, we're all in the same boat here together. Right. We talked about potential mates, right, current mates. Right. I mean, should you tell your boss? Insurance, yeah, companies, will they know? Right. This is a lot of information,
right,
here.
So right now you have no duty to tell your insurance company, but your disability insurance or your life insurance company can ask you if they want. It's legal for them to ask you. Your health insurer cannot ask you. But in terms of telling your family members, it's a very difficult issue, and people respond very differently. When I did my test, I got a whole bunch of stuff, and then a few months later, I got my Alzheimer's test back, the Alzheimer gene that they're talking about in the show. And I'm sitting there with my 9-year-old son, and I get the results on my computer, and I say, I'm not sure I want to open this with him there. Luckily, I came out clean on it, and it's okay. But, you know, if I come out with two positives, which I'm sure I had because I'm forgetting things, as we all are as we get older, I don't want to get that reaction in front of him and say, you got this gene as a 9-year-old.
This dilemma has existed with so-called single genes, mm-hmm, where a single gene, a so-called Mendelian disorder, if you carry the gene and your partner carries the gene and one of your children carries two copies of the gene, they will get the disease. So if you look at things like in the Ashkenazi Jewish population, diseases like Tay-Sachs, the Jewish community actually has a counseling service whereby people can anonymously know who they should not potentially marry as a consequence of dealing with genetic liability, where we're now moving to the question of tests which involve tens, potentially thousands of genes interacting. This is much more complex, and we're just not there yet.
And please.
I was just going to say, and we also don't know, just because the test comes back, you know, you have this and this and this, that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to pass it on to your children. We still don't know what all of the genes in the genome mean. The single gene disorders are easier because if you pass it on, you are or you aren't going to get it, or if your spouse has it or carrier genes, there's all questions there. But these complex conditions, autism, heart disease, are going to be multiple genes, environmental factors.
That brings up embryonic selection. I mean, how far does that go? How far do ethics suggest you can take that?
You can take it pretty far right now. I mean, I trained as a genetic counselor down at U of A, and there are prenatal tests out there that women can get that they can also do before implantation, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. If there's a test, they can do it currently.
But it brings us back to that critical issue of what I call the most dangerous words, genes for, implying it's deterministic.
Yes.
And that is true for the single gene disorders. If you get the gene and have two copies of the gene, then tragically you will have the disease. But in these much more complex late onset disorders like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's disease, cancer, diabetes, and so forth, it's a far more complex picture.
And we're talking about health issues here. We've only got a minute or so left. The criminal justice system could be turned upside down with the idea that I couldn't help it because I've got this, that, and the other.
Yeah, so there's a couple dozen cases using that argument right now in the court systems of the United States. I've talked to several of the judges handling those cases, and they're coming out differently. Some, they're saying it isn't relevant, we're not going to consider it. Others, it's being introduced to the jurors, and the juries are making a decision based on that to give a much more lenient penalty. And so, you know, again, these are not deterministic genes. Again, they just simply increase your risk combined with a bad environment of being a criminal, but it's not 100%.
And it extends to other issues such as addiction, alcohol, drugs, and so forth.
Last word, how do we prepare for this brave new world?
We need more genetic counselors. We need people who can explain to people what genetics means in terms that they'll understand. And unfortunately, there's only about 3,000 in the United States.
Wow. So. All right. Well, I'm sure there'll be more here soon. Great conversation. Good to have you all here. Thanks for joining.
Thank you very much.